Okay. I have some notes.
Okay. And you'll... Okay. Fantastic.
Okay. Shall we start?
Sure.
Yeah. Okay, we're starting. So we have 5 minutes late, so we're starting right now. Let me just briefly introduce the panel. I'm Fabio Chiusi. I'm a journalist for L'Espresso and a fellow of the Nexa Center in Turin. And with me is Hossein Derakhshan, a Canadian Iranian blogger and author, and Mathew Ingram for Fortune magazine. And it's quite a good company. And the panel is How to Fight Back Against Big Data. And I don't particularly like the catchphrase big data, you know, because it obscures more than it tells and it reveals. And I think we should, in technology, get rid of such, you know, marketing, PR-oriented words. I prefer talking about algorithms, which is instead a quite technical and precise term, a set of instructions to do something, you know, in a finite number of passages. The problem is that when you have a lot of data, of course, nobody would say having more data is bad. Instead, when you're talking of algorithms and the influence you have in the lives of people, there are some quite bad consequences of having life driven by algorithms. And that's what we're about to talk. Just a brief brief introduction on the issue for those who are not into this topic. Algorithms have given way to a lot of bad instances of behavior. For example, we have automatic decisions that lead to automatic discriminations, which is a growing field of research. And we have a lot of bad consequences in biases in data sets, for example, in code, which are enshrined in code, in e-rating systems that influence the way in which you're judged, in which you get credit, for example, in your insurance rates and everything. We have algorithms that claim to be objective, but in fact they are not. And again, they hide some political discourse or maybe ideological discourse or motivations that are the ones of those who created the algorithms, which right now, most of the times, is still human beings and not other algorithms, even if it's possible. Algorithms also essentially have no ethics, whereas, in fact, again, they embody and they enshrine the ethics of their creators, and we totally lack, or almost totally lack, a discussion on the ethics of algorithms, and this has bad consequences as well. Some algorithms are even non-human rights compliant, and I can remember Michael Hayden, General Michael Hayden, former director of the CIA at the NSA, say we kill people based on metadata, and these metadata most of the times are computed by algorithms. So these are very, very important consequences for human beings. And of course, one of the questions I would like to put out here is how to make algorithms human right compliant. And sometimes we know a lot of about fake news and things like that, you know, even another catchphrase that I personally hate. But again, this is a very real problem. Algorithms can go against democracy, against media pluralism, against the truth or some so-called truth. Algorithms are not transparent. Most of the times we don't know why we see what we see on Facebook, why we see what we see on Google. You know, we lack precise criteria. We don't really know what's going on there, and that's a problem too. And then, and we can go on forever, but I want to pass on to my co-panelists. And another problem is that we have algorithms against spam, for example, that become algorithms against extremism. And again, they become censorship. So you start out with something that should be completely straightforward. You don't want spam to, you know, bother you all the time on the internet. And instead, you end up with systems of filtering systems, automatic filtering systems for having to do with extremism, propaganda, and that ultimately lead to censorship, which is a kind of a huge problem. Like some days ago, Twitter said that more than 250,000 accounts have been suspended by algorithms and filters built to find spam, but employed to combat the specter of violent extremism. This is a serious issue, you know, not just because of the propaganda we're exposed to, but also for the things that we lose when we censor some kind of contents. So we lack basically everything when we deal with this issue, even if we start to talk about it quite extensively. And my first question to the panel is it possible at all to fight back against all of this? Because algorithms are so pervasive and so everywhere in our lives. They even, you know, drive market transactions. They do everything. They're about to start driving cars themselves. Everything is, they start to be delivering fruit and vegetables via drones, you know. It's going to be crazy. And the internet is going to be into everything with the Internet of Things. Estimates vary, but of course, we know that maybe 50 billion objects will be connected by 2025. This is Huawei estimate. I'm going, you know, on memory. But they're going to be everywhere. So what to do? Is it the first question I think that we should be asking in a panel that aims to build a resistance against all this is it possible to do it at all? Who wants to start?
It's more experience.
I think it's definitely possible. I think it takes a lot of effort on the part of the user to... I think there are two things you can do. One is to be aware, and I think that's sort of the first battle, is to become informed about when algorithms are affecting you, affecting the way you perceive the world, affecting what you're doing. I like to ask civilians, as I call them, people who aren't in the news industry, who aren't in tech, I ask them whether they know that Facebook filters their news feed and shows them certain things and doesn't show them other things. And over 50% of the people I ask are unaware of that. So these people Wow. don't know that the view that they're getting of the world through Facebook is filtered by an algorithm. And I think the danger there is not so much that Facebook is doing something bad, but that their view of the world is being determined in a way for them, and they don't know that. And so I think part of what the media needs to do, part of what people in general need to do, is to educate themselves and others about when algorithms are being used and what that means. I mean, the word algorithm to a lot of people is just Greek. Of course, it is Greek. But anyway, it doesn't mean anything. They don't know what an algorithm is. They don't know how they function. But if you explain, Facebook only shows you certain things, and it decides what to show you and what not to show you, and it's based on what it knows about you or what it thinks it knows about you, then I think that, you know, gives people an idea, at least, of what they're dealing with. And then they can decide, well, I don't care whether Facebook is determining what to show me, and that's fine. That's a choice. But at least it's an informed choice as opposed to something that's imposed on them. And the second thing I think we can do is, and Hossein has a couple of interesting ideas about this, is to effectively try and hack the algorithms that are trying to control you. And not, I don't mean hack them the way a programmer would, or you're free to do that if you are a programmer. I'm not. I like to try and confuse algorithms because I'm afraid that they're determining things in a way that I don't like. I don't have any evidence of that, but it's a fear. And so I like to try and do things that are unpredictable. I like to try and randomize the inputs that I use and randomize the information that I see. I deliberately juggle, for example, Twitter accounts that I follow and unfollow. I try to follow accounts that I would not normally follow. I deliberately follow people who believe the opposite of the things I do. I'm trying to keep the filter bubble from becoming as constricting as I think algorithms would like it to be. I don't want to live in that kind of bubble. And so I try to seek out differences and the odd or unusual because I'm hoping either that the algorithm will be smart enough to recognize that and show me those things, or that I will confuse it and therefore it won't show me as much sort of similar things.
Yeah, when you said this, to my mind goes to the book published by MIT Press called Obfuscation by Finn Branton mm-hmm. and Nussbaum, and they say exactly the same, just try to fool the algorithm. You know, they're just not good enough at the moment to compute whether you're actually saying the truth when you say that you're a blonde, you know, beautiful girl. And
I don't usually say that.
Yeah, exactly. Me neither. But it's easily recognizable by a human, you know, but not maybe by not by algorithm. And so I'm passing on the question, the same question. Do you think is it possible? Because awareness here is very important. And of course, being aware of the basics is a good start. But then again, when you go into the details, you know, we had Adam Mosseri here this morning, and we have a very good presentation from Facebook, but we lack any of the details about the newsfeed function. We have just broad criteria, you know. So even if we are aware, we don't really know how to hack.
The worst part is it's a black box. Facebook will not tell you. I mean, Google does this as well. They don't disclose how it functions. And so you have to sort of reverse engineer how it's functioning by seeing what the outputs are. And I think one of the risks is Facebook's response is, it's just showing you what you want to see. So the algorithm is just a machine that shows you things that you will like. But that's not what it is at all.
No.
It's what a group of engineers decided was the output that conforms to what they think you like based on certain activity that you perform on Facebook.
Yeah, it's also telling what you should like,
right?
Which is kind of different. Well, what's your take?
I would like to start from a theoretical point, which is, and I love this idea of Michel Foucault, the French historian of ideas. He says that where there is power, exactly in that point, there is resistance. Huh. So that gives me an idea of how you can resist against super powerful things. And now that we all faced with this dominance of algorithms, the personal data that they gather about us, and they're going to be using it against us, not in our benefit, definitely, in credit records, in insurance matters, in everything that has something to do with money and banking and these things. And predictions, because they all use these to predict us. And once they can predict us, there's no question for them anymore. And they can completely control us by having access to this information that enables them to predict our behavior. So if you start from this formula, in a way, of resistance, then you would be able to locate these points of resistance. And when I have been thinking about this, you could do two things, basically, when you're faced with this problem. You can either sit back and refuse to participate in this process, which is the equivalent of going into caves. This is something that you might have heard from Bible. It also exists in the Quran, the story of a few people who escaped from a very violent, pagan king at the time, and they were Christians. They went to a cave and they slept, and once they woke up, they realized that hundreds of years has passed, and they had not noticed that. They wanted to stay away from things, and they went to this cave. We cannot do that now. I mean, we can, but we would end up like Osama bin Laden at the end, I think. What we can do is easier, I would say, and maybe a bit more creative. If we cannot refuse to participate in this process, we can produce too much information, too much untrustworthy information. We can contaminate the data that is being gathered about us by not being completely truthful in our preferences, in our ideas, in our behaviors, in our engagement, basically. So if we randomize, for instance, now on social networks, if we manage to randomize our engagement, what we like, what we don't like, what we share, what we send, or what actually even what we look at, or what search keywords we actually put on Google, then we would be able to make, if there is enough people, if there is a small percentage of people doing this, then if you are Google, if you are Facebook, then you wouldn't be able to say if that specific piece of information is genuine, because you know there is a small percentage of contaminated data or untruthful data gathered from some people, and because you cannot spot that part of wrong information, then they wouldn't be able to use it the way they would like to. So, and I'm sure I know of some people who are doing some technical things to do this. For instance, there is a plugin written by, I don't remember his name. I saw it on Twitter last week. He actually had produced, I think, a plugin for a browser plugin that would, while you're sleeping, it would produce search terms, and it would search basically random things on behalf of you, and then the data that would be collected about you would be completely randomized based on that. So I think this is a new approach to this algorithm-dominated world, where I think very soon anyone who has control on algorithms has more power. The future wars, probably, the future political wars would be about who to control algorithms. They would replace ideologies in many ways, and maybe they have already. So it's very important to have some sort of resistance mechanism against these things, because soon, not only us, but even our devices at home, fridge, television, you know, heaters, air conditioning, they will all be producing a lot of data about us. And we can produce randomized data by any of these devices and by ourselves to confuse them and to contaminate them, so the big companies cannot trust them and cannot use them against us as citizens.
Yeah, I totally agree. I was just wondering whether this thing by Foucault, but this thought by Foucault, where is power, there is resistance, still apply in the age of Facebook, you know, because Facebook has spread like wildfire, and actually there have been no great resistance to any of its moves, you know, except for some particular privacy policies. I'm thinking about, for example, WhatsApp trying to get the name and contacts from Facebook, whereas they said, you know, for years they said they wouldn't have, and then they tried, and then they had to backtrack, you know, when people started complaining and only institutions started complaining and threatened to take action against that. But again, it's just a minimum part of the whole framework, you know, and the whole scenario to me is that, you know, we may be needing some larger form of resistance, which is questioning the very heart of their business model, which is putting efficiency as the ultimate human value. You know, when you buy this assumption and that everything must be efficient, and that everything must be, you know, immediate or non-mediated, you know, or just mediated by some kind of platform. And because having Uber, for example, makes public transportation more efficient, you know, mm-hmm. Except there are no there is no public transportation anymore, or housing, you know, with Airbnb, for example, yeah. Or Facebook, you know, makes more efficient connecting to somebody in some other place, you know. But again, this has a lot of bad consequences. So what I'm not seeing, and I would like to see maybe, is more of, together with this kind of resistance of obfuscation and the like, I would like to see some more thought opposition, you know, some kind of intellectual resistance to all of this. Because my perception is that, you know, the only ideology where all of us are actually buying is no more neoliberalism, it's Silicon Valley, you know. Mm-hmm. And that's scaring me, actually. I don't know if you all agree with that, But
I mean, I'm a little conflicted in a way, because I think algorithms do lots of things that are worthwhile.
Yeah.
I mean, the simple fact of having an algorithm is not bad.
Definitely.
The fact that you automated a process that took people a long time and a lot of boring drudge work or math or whatever is not inherently bad. It's that the outcome of the algorithm determines the service. The service shapes the individual to some extent. The individual's behavior is then controlled to some extent by the algorithm. Maybe they're denied healthcare. Maybe they're treated differently because their behavior suggests something about them. Maybe they're added to a watch list. Those are the things that are bad. So it's, to me, I want to be as aware as possible of the outcomes of the algorithms that are all around me. I don't need to know how they function necessarily, although, you know, a bit more information than zero would be nice. But I don't need to know sort of the details. I want to know what things are being determined based on that. What am I being denied? What am I being subjected to? What am I missing? What am I, you know, where am I, what lists am I winding up on?
Yeah, there are a lot of examples. So there's a question, of course.
So why did we surrender? Why can't I have the algorithm running it on my computer? When did we decide it was okay for Facebook to be the only algorithm?
Yeah.
I mean, we never considered the possibility that we could own the algorithm instead of them.
Yeah.
We could, I think.
Yeah. Usually when I speak about this, I put this... this technique of resistance.
Dave Weiner.
Yeah.
The tough questions come from tough people. I know.
Okay. It's a good question.
Yeah. This is only on a personal level, but this is not enough. This kind of resistance definitely is not enough. We need to think about structural ways of resistance, and I think one of them would definitely start from the point that you just mentioned, which I call it a social level of resistance, which is raising awareness about the very fact that these algorithms have alternatives. There are many other kinds of algorithms that could actually be functioning on any of these things. And the very fact that they have this monopoly, that they can decide what kind of algorithms they dominate on your news feeds or on your life, and they never disclose what they do and how they do it. This is problematic. So I think if there is enough awareness, a public awareness about the fact that not all kinds of algorithms are bad, but we have to know more about them and we have to be able to choose algorithms, because this has been also an idea of allowing third-party algorithms, forcing these companies to accept third-party algorithms, so you would be able to choose, even buy maybe, there would be even a market for algorithm writers. So you would be able to choose what kind of algorithms you want on your Twitter or Facebook news feeds, or even for your fridge, you know, when it automatically connects to a shop and orders for you the stuff that you're running out of. These kinds of stuff. And then on a higher level, which I think is the most effective one, is a political level. And I think because of the power that they exert on everybody's lives, these algorithms, they should be regulated. Definitely they should be regulated by governments. Otherwise, basically, governments become pointless and meaningless, because that's one of the biggest functions, to regulate the power of private entities, and this is completely being forgotten now that everything is becoming algorithm driven. And I'm very happy to say that a few months ago I saw that Angela Merkel had said this. She said that algorithms are exerting too much power on individuals' lives, and they have to be regulated.
Would you agree with that?
No.
No. Okay.
I'm not sure I would agree.
Just a second, just to finish the answer.
I'm not a fan of government regulation in general. I'm not. I don't think we need more things to be regulated by government. I think in general that leads to sort of entrenched interests, monopolies, oligopolies, and bad service. So I would much rather, I'm not saying the government shouldn't have a role in, say, encouraging an open marketplace, say, in requiring certain standards, so regulatory of some kind.
Minimum regulation.
Then I can agree. And certainly, Dave, I would agree, if there were more open choices, would people choose to do that? If you could say, look, you can achieve all the things you achieve on Facebook, but you're in control and the whole process is open and federated. If there were that option, would lots of people choose that? I would like to think they would. Certainly we could maybe exert more force on Facebook to provide more choice, to have multiple ways of looking at your feed instead of just one. I'd certainly go along with that.
Yeah, question.
In Germany, we just had this this draft of a new law that wants to regulate hate speech on Facebook. Mm-hmm. And it's still not clear how it will end up, but the draft didn't look that promising. There are a lot of problematic passages in that.
Yeah.
But I don't understand why we have so little conversations as journalists about this, because at the end of the day, this is such a crucial point. And I think the argument that it's dangerous to get the government involved is sort of obsolete because the government is involved. Like, I mean, Facebook is so crucial that it's government is part of Facebook, and it will be. So I just read this parallel that Facebook or the whole election debacle can be compared with the financial crisis, and is that there is a crucial system, crucial for society, but it's totally opaque, no one understands it. And that's, for me, is a little bit puzzling why we don't have that conversation, why people are demanding that. They're like,
but look at what happened in the financial services. There was a regulatory agency, the government was involved, and they actually accelerated it and it made it worse.
But as journalists, I mean, we failed in the pre-run of the financial crisis, and I think we fail now as well, because we always discuss this conversation on a very broad, ideologically laden basis, but as journalists, we simply lack the expertise to report on that in a meaningful way. And one of the reasons, of course, goes back to funding, because a lot of the people who would be qualified enough to actually have a qualified opinion on algorithms, they would never work for a journalist's salary.
How do even journalists wouldn't work for journalist salaries, you know, yeah. So most of the time. So,
It would be interesting on your opinion, but what do you think we should deal with this situation?
Which situation?
That we don't really report on algorithms in a qualified way, and how we should regulate them.
I think we need to do more. I mean, that's part of what I was trying to describe in terms of transparency and awareness. I think we need more. We need more discussion, panels, more openness, more transparency, more education. I think a lot of the, even if we were to have conversations about this, a lot of people would just tune out because I don't think they understand how it affects them. So I think we need more discussion of that.
And we also need to check, if I may add, the intervention of government regulations. I'm agnostic about it. I think there are more solutions to different situations, you know. But we need to be careful about these kind of laws that are being proposed, because most of the times they don't actually solve any problems.
No.
They just add layers of complications. They add to censorship. They add to limitations. So this is another issue for journalists, I guess.
I think government regulation of speech of any kind is a bad idea.
Yeah.
Period.
That's for sure. Question like that?
Hello, John Crowley here from the International Business Times.
Hi,
Matthew. I think most journalists would agree that government regulation is a bad thing, but has the horse bolted so far that there isn't any other recourse? You know, are we already convinced that if we go to Facebook, we go to the platform and say, hey, let's put pressure on you, please, can you open up your algo to us, that they're going to go, hey, sure. I mean, is this the last recourse of action where governments get involved?
I'm afraid it could be. I'm just leery of rushing in. There's nothing we can do, so we better get the government involved. You know, the worst words you can hear are, I'm from the government and I'm here to help. So, because it inevitably leads to chaos and disaster. I think we're in agreement that the government needs to have a role. I just would like it not to be they decide, you know, what speech is appropriate, or they decide which algorithms are useful, or they decide which social platforms should exist and which shouldn't.
You want to jump in?
We're fully capable of screwing things up without the government. So
I think, I mean, I don't think anyone would have any problem with the idea of government or legislators to force companies at least to disclose some information about the algorithms. This is one kind of intervention. It's not regulating speech. It's regulating operations. It's regulating
disclosure,
structures.
Yeah. I agree.
So if it's about structures and formulas, I don't think there is any problem. It's already happening in many fields. Look at alcohol, cigarettes, health, anything that is related to health. Driving, traffic. There is so much regulations about these things, and nobody is complaining about them. But when it comes to technology, when it comes to Silicon Valley, suddenly regulation becomes a taboo word, and people are suddenly scared of it.
And perhaps there's a requirement. Perhaps there's a requirement that if you have a large social platform or a large search engine, it's incumbent on you to provide certain things. Maybe not all the details of the algorithm, but maybe open interfaces in a certain way, maybe allowing infrastructure and sort of internetworking, maybe, because Facebook basically allows zero. If you write a plugin or something that screws with the feed, they will nuke you from orbit. So maybe if there were a few more requirements that allowed you to do stuff like that, I'd certainly be in favor of that.
Yeah, maybe serendipity requirements, you know. Why not?
That would be a tough one.
Yeah.
How do you engineer serendipity?
Yeah, well, when you know the ideological stance of somebody, you can take the opposite and insert it into newsfeed. It's anti-economic for them,
well,
but it's good for democracy, you know.
Is it? I don't want to agree a lot with Facebook, but Adam Mosseri made a good point, which is if you simply present the opposite view to someone, it actually makes them more entrenched in their existing view. It doesn't force them out of their...
It
has to be more subtle than that.
Yeah, that's also would be my next point. You know, is we maybe need more science on these issues before jumping into regulations. Because, for example, filter bubbles are being hotly debated, and the effects are, you know, if you take Facebook studies, it's not a problem at all. If you take some other studies, it's a huge problem that is killing democracy.
We need programmers, but also sociologists, psychologists.
Yeah.
You know, economists.
Everybody needs to be involved, definitely. Next question.
I think I'm with Matthew on not having the government intervene, but I agree with you that there is some role. But the thing that scares me, and I live in America, so that is the perspective I come from. We talk a lot about news literacy. I find our legislators understand least about these things. We literally have politicians who run with great pride that, I've never been on email, or it's nuts to me, you know, and the idea that they can't understand when, you know, Anthony Weiner's computer was found. How can they check, 200,000 documents in 9 days? It was like, well, they can do it in 3 minutes. But so, I mean, what are your thoughts on actually educating our politicians and the people who
in favor of it.
The people who make decisions, because technology and legislation are so far apart. You know, it is illegal for anyone to open my mail that comes from the postman. There are no such restrictions on information that is distributed technologically. It has implications for the Fourth Amendment. And I feel that one thing we are missing in our conversation about, you know, the democracy that we live in and what we all need to learn, and so much is talked about how we as citizens have to learn. What is the obligation of our politicians to learn and understand this world of big data that we live in? Maybe it's okay in other countries, but in the U.S. it certainly isn't.
I think that's a huge problem. I mean, you can't have the people who are making the laws not understand the things that they're dealing with. I mean, you certainly wouldn't let somebody make laws about cars who didn't understand how driving functions, or who had never seen an internal combustion engine, you know, there has to be a certain level of knowledge. I don't know how you require that. I certainly think we could expect that of the people that we vote for. There's a huge sort of knowledge gap, knowledge bankruptcy when it comes to that sort of thing. And yet they're the ones that are making the laws that are controlling the outcome. I think if we can force them to learn those things, we certainly should.
Yeah, but I think that would disappear in one generation. That wouldn't be an issue in 10 years because the younger people who are brought up on these technologies would become the legislators.
I think it might be a little longer than 10 years with our system. But look at the warp speed with
the
which
American
things are changing.
Yeah. Yes.
I mean, things change so fast. Goodness knows what's going to happen in that time.
I don't think we can afford to wait either.
Right, so that's the conundrum, you know. What is our role in helping people understand, not just the consumers of our journalism, but the consumers of our journalism on Capitol Hill as well?
We need to elect more teenagers.
Yeah, my point is we need to better translate the scientific knowledge that we already have into everyday knowledge, you know, things that people need to can learn and actually understand. We cannot give them, you know, the full studies. We can also give them, of course, because the internet is powerful, and as long as JSTOR doesn't oppose, you know, and public knowledge is actually public, you know, as it should be, you know, and we can have an informed opinion about that.
But that's something journalists can do. I mean, our job is to make things understandable. Yeah, we could probably do a better job of that.
Yeah, we could probably have, like, proper, you know, institution or an organization, media organizations that are actually translating scientific knowledge into everyday knowledge. That's my point. That will help, I guess.
Maybe remedial classes for politicians, you know, where they go and study how computers work.
Yeah,
that workshops.
Earning their pay, you know. Why not?
I first wanted to say that I'm so happy for this panel because I think we really missed that perspective on the whole thing. We're talking on fake news all the time and Trump and I don't know what and all the things already happening online, happening on the algorithms, happen on Facebook, on Google, but not on the meter level, not on the structure. And I wanted to highlight this is probably not about governmental control, but it is about political guarantees for free traffic of information. And this is not so transparency, guaranteed transparency. And definitely this is something journalists should fight for. And this is something we have to force the big algorithms to do because there is not an alternative to it. Because I perfectly understand that there's always a kind of a bad feeling when it's about governmental control. But now we are running into monopolies that we just don't look into. And of course, in the beginning you said we have the possibility to kind of impact, influence what kind of information is taken from us, but we don't have any possibility to control or to impact what information is given to us. And I think we have to crash that situation, definitely.
Totally agree.
Definitely.
More Dave? Questions? Dave, you said you were done. You said you only had...
It's my turn.
Go ahead.
I'm just kidding. We got one here. Go ahead. This is important.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, boy.
This is very important. So I need to speak in English. So I want to thank you, all of you, especially Fabio Chiusi, because before meeting you, I didn't know anything about algorithms and so on, you know. I don't have Facebook, I don't have anything. But before meeting you, I didn't know anything about love. And now it's been 1 year and a half, and I feel so honored, blessed, grateful to be your human and to stay with you. And I really want to say that I love you. And because I'm so proud of you and of us. We are maybe a way to fight against big data and so on is love, I think. Love is revolution. So maybe are you free on the 29th of August in Sarajevo to marry me?
I'm free.
Oh,
I am. I actually am.
Is 29 is okay?
What?
It's 29?
Yeah, definitely, yes. Definitely.
Okay, we have a day.
Yes.
We have a day.
Thank you very much.
Mary.
This is not an egg,
okay.
This is me.
Oh, boy. I know, this is beautiful.
This is okay. This is the most interesting panel I've ever been on. I don't think that's ever happened before.
This is definitely a way to get day one in a good mood, you know.
But anyway. A marriage proposal. You gotta top that. You gotta top that.
Yeah. I have to kiss them.
Yes. Yes. August.
No. Actually, no.
It's going to be right here.
It's going to be the roof on it.
No, no.
Oh, Sarajevo, okay.
I really wonder how you go on there.
Yeah, I don't know what we can...
Please question
I
the public.
I hope it wasn't fake news.
No, no.
It
no
could
fake
be.
News.
You never know.
No
That's
fake news.
That's how it's connected back to the...
No
to
fake
the
news, but yeah, questions, please.
Dave, did you still have a question?
No. We... Anyone? We killed the panel. Okay.
You don't. Yeah. You don't have to top that. Just, but questions are okay.
Okay. No, seriously, we still have 10 minutes, so we need to talk. Please.
Yeah. Hi. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm from the Jordan Media Institute, and I've attended a few sessions since. Yesterday, and we've heard a lot about journalists complaining and then criticizing themselves and then complaining again. And, but we haven't heard solutions to many of the issues raised during many of the sessions. So, the issues you raised, it's either I'm slow or I need to go back home with some answers. And how can we deal with all this? I'm involved in a media information literacy project in Jordan. And so we see a lot, we're trying to deal with all this data and how people can analyze the information and how to do it ethically and especially on social media and how to do privacy settings, how to be careful because we work with school children.
Yeah.
And so...
I think you're already doing it. I mean, I certainly couldn't recommend...
Is it just about awareness? Should we just... Because we can't stop the flow.
I think it starts with awareness.
It has
to start with awareness. So literacy, information literacy, social media literacy, yes. And certainly with children, it's not just politicians. Yes. I've seen some frightening studies of high school students who... did not know, could not recognize what was happening. This was in the form of fake news. They couldn't distinguish between an advertisement and a non-advertisement. They couldn't distinguish between a fake news article and a real news article.
Or a story and an opinion.
Or a story and an opinion, yeah. And so those types of things, the problems those can cause, I think, are huge, and yet it's a relatively... easy solution to try. It's education, and I think we educate kids about so many things. It shouldn't be that hard to get them to notice that on an ad it says sponsored in large type. It's not rocket surgery. That should be relatively easy to figure out. I think it has to be. It has to start small and then build. So. Education is the first building block, and then you raise awareness, and then some people want to take action or become involved, and a movement builds. That's how. But I certainly can't think of anything you should do that you're not doing.
We need the media as well.
Yes, yeah, definitely. And that's part of the education process.
Yeah, I think too. You know, when we speak of government education, and we definitely need media education on technology. Imagine reporting on cyber attacks. You know, it's very tough. You have attribution problem. It's tough for technicians. It's very tough for media not to become propagandists of some kind of views. So
I think media, we do tend, and I fall into this trap too.
Yeah.
If you're writing about technology, and you tend to use the jargon that the industry uses.
Exactly.
And this happens all the time. It happens in government. It happens in other industries. You fall into that because that's what the people you're reporting on, that's how they talk. But that's not helpful to people who aren't already part of that. It pushes them away. And I think we have to force ourselves, editors are a good way of doing this, force ourselves to stop using the shorthand and the jargon and the sort of code words, because those things exclude people.
Yeah, and we definitely need to know more about crypto, you know, more about the technical stuff too, in order to really understand. Because most of, you know, of the profiling that has been done on each of us has to do with us being visible to them. You know, if we manage to be less visible to them, you know, maybe their profiling can be worse. You know, so it doesn't solve everything. But for example, when you talk mass surveillance, if crypto scales, it becomes much more difficult and less economical for them. You know, in economic terms, it's much less convenient for them to actually try and surveil everybody, because it takes a lot of more effort. They can still maybe target someone if they really want to, and maybe crypto is not enough, but you know, still knowing how to check whether there is some kind of interference in your communication, you know. And that's especially for journalists, you know, that I think, and for me too, I would love to attend such class, you know. I would definitely love to. And I don't know why we couldn't like really mandate it for everyone. It's we're all dealing with technology, you know. We should know what we're dealing with, you know.
Yeah.
I would love to know more about this kind of technical side of the issue, you know. Definitely. There's some other questions?
I just want to add something.
Sure.
There is also this danger. I mean, now that you see that you see the collapse of public education system around the world, the collapse of welfare states, the privatization of education. And when you see this and you put this next to these huge empires of cash that are coming from technology. I mean, Google, Facebook, they are becoming really huge empires. And they are the ones who are probably going to fund many of private education institutions, or at least to contribute to them. So then how would you expect this privatized education system to work against the interests of its sponsors? So that's another case, again, for against the neoliberal realities of our world now, especially in North America and in many other parts of the world, unfortunately.
I think we could encourage people as well. Like, I think people, even if they think about this stuff, they think, well, Facebook is a $500 billion organization. What could I possibly do? You know, and I think there's lots of things that people could do. They could make their voices heard. They could ask for change. They could pressure a company. I mean, companies are vulnerable to customer complaints. They're vulnerable to boycotts. Those types of things raise awareness. I think there's lots of things people could do, even if they're not programmers.
Yeah, pressure groups, specific pressure groups about these topics, lobbies who focus on these things, they could have an effect, but I'm not sure how much.
Yeah. Promise to,
and it should be through legislation, otherwise it wouldn't be effective.
Yeah, they should be powerful enough. That's the problem. You know?
Yeah,
Google, Facebook, and these big giants have powerful lobbies. You know, they're powerful interests, so it's tough to oppose. You know, sometimes they do good things. You know, they oppose. For example, I was in Brussels at RightsCon last week, and they all were talking about internet shutdowns. You know, and they, and Facebook, Google, and they played a huge part of it because, of course, it's in their interest. But again, it's in everybody's interest, you know, that internet doesn't get shut down. Again, shut down doesn't mean anything here, you know, most of the time, so it's another catchphrase. But again, it's a good thing. The problem is when you have, like, powerful interests that work against the public interest, you know, and that's really much tougher to oppose.
You can also find support, I think, or at least help in unusual places sometimes. So in the U.S., laws were effectively repealed that would have forced ISPs to not release personal information, to sell it to advertisers and so on. And when this was reported, lots of conservative supporters of Trump, and you would assume supporters of his laws, said, wait, what? They're doing what? And they said that this was not what they had in mind. You can often find, by explaining what's happening in simple terms, people who just weren't aware that that was even a problem could become a supporter, could become a critic of the whatever the government's trying to do.
Yeah. Last question?
Just a quick question. Have you tried to get someone from Facebook to join us here to discuss this?
Someone from Facebook to...
From Facebook or these big players here. Oh, I think they're missing in this dialogue.
Oh, okay. I
agree.
It would be great to hear from them.
Oh, definitely. If there is someone from Facebook here, can please take... we're happy. We'd be happy to hear from them. You know.
I think I know where to find them.
I know. I don't know.
Drag one.
But of course, it's not just Facebook, you know, it's a lot of companies.
They're busy controlling what you see and stuff like that. They just don't have time.
Yeah. Okay, so if there is one last question or no?
We're all going to see things about marriages this today in our news feeds.
Okay, so thanks.
The marriage panel.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you for coming.
So was it real?
Oh yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. The next session, we're solving all the problems that we just.
Nice.
Where is the next session? Right here. So stay right here if you want solutions. Is anyone going to get married in your session? No.